Hey guys, welcome to my legal classes. I was covering the Transfer of Property Act 1882 through different sessions. In the last class, we have covered section number 13 to understand the transfer for benefit of unborn person. And prior to that, we have also covered a series on restriction on alienation of property, where we have covered section number 10, 11, 12, 17 and 18. In this session, I will be concentrating on Rule Against Perpetuity, that is section number 14. Yeah, the section number 14 speaks about Rule Against Perpetuity, but I am looking at other sections also. They are 15, 16, 17 and 18 because they are closely connected to Rules Against Perpetuity. Now, section number 17 and 18, I will not be repeating because I have covered already when I was doing restriction on alienation of property. So you can go through that sections. The video is already available. And to understand, you can understand section number 17 and 18 there. But I'll definitely do an independent session on section number 15 and 16 after this class, because this will be a comprehensive effort to understand section number 14. And I don't want to bring too much of concepts here in this section. And this is an attempt to comprehensively cover all section number 14. I have brought a lot of aspects of section number 14 in this session to help you to craft your answer for the questions on Rules Against Perpetuity, as well as when you are practicing law. This session will help you to understand what exactly is the concept all about. Now, like any other sessions of mine, you will always have few images in the session. The main purpose of keeping images to help you to understand the concept. All my images in the presentation is connected to the topic. Now, if you see this slide, I have kept a beach scene where a lot of tides are coming in. Now, the question is, can you tie the tides? Answer is no. Likewise, when you are having a property, can you tie it forever? The answer is no, as per section number 14, which is speaking about rule against perpetuity. So the entire section says, just like you cannot tie the tides of the sea, you cannot tie the property of yours forever and ever. So I'll be covering this concept in this session and hope it will be easy for you to understand when we go through few other slides of this session. Let us move on. What does it mean? The word meaning of perpetuity, the state or quality of lasting forever, or a bond or other security with no fixed maturity date, or forever, or something that is perpetual and unending. Let us take the last meaning, which is saying forever or something that is perpetual and unending. So the word meaning is, there is no end for something is called perpetual. So this rule, section number 14, says this is a rule against perpetuity. That means the property transfer cannot be perpetual. It should have an end. So that is what covered under section number 14. Without confusing you too much, let's go through the definition of section number 14. And my next slide will give you the complete meaning of section number 14. And after seeing that, you'll be requiring few other aspects just to fill in the answer sheet, which are covered in many other slides of this presentation. Now, what does section number 14 says? No transfer of property can operate to create an interest which is to take effect after the lifetime of one or more persons living at the date of such transfer, and the minority of some person who shall be in existence at the expiration of the period, and to whom, if he attains full age, the interest created is to belong. It gives a meaning that you can transfer your property to any number of living people, but the final transfer should be to, or can be to, an unborn person, but just one unborn person, not unlimited. That's all about rule against perpetuity. So you can transfer the property to any number of living person, but finally, it can go to only one unborn person. If you are transferring to an unborn person, it can be to only one unborn person, and that's with absolute transfer. That is covered under section number 13 already. So now you are getting a connection, I hope, that how exactly the section number 13 and 14 are connected. Let's go to the next slide, which again I have put some images to help you understand how exactly this section applies. Moving on, the maximum timeline in section number 14 I am trying to cover in this slide. Let's understand prior to that a case law where they have said that all the candles simultaneously lit would wear out and die together. This was told in the Kettle versus Palmer case, where the property was transferred to 26 living persons, and it was held that this transfer is valid because all the candles simultaneously lit would wear out and die together. If you see below, I have given three images. Just look at the first two images where I have lit, I mean, not me exactly, we have lit some candles, and all the candles are lit. There is no candle without lit. So all the candles are lit. Now, what is the maximum timeline of these candles? Now, you know, it may take 30 minutes, 40 minutes or 50 minutes, but it is not like forever and ever. It is not perpetual. There is a timeline for these candles. They will burn out and they will die. Likewise, you can transfer your property to any number of living person. Just after Kettle versus Palmer case, if you see the first line where I have mentioned, you can transfer your property to any number of living persons. For example, you are transferring to A for 2 years, after that 5 years to B, and then again 1 year to C, and then 10 years to D. Whatsoever you want to do with the living persons, your property, your wish, you can transfer to any number of people. That's possible under the Transfer of Property Act. But then you can have one unborn person. If you want to bring an unborn person at the end of this transfers, you can have only one unborn person, and that will be the last person of this transfer, and he will get absolute power on the property, absolute right on the property. Now, what is the maximum timeline? With timeline of pregnancy and attaining majority. So this is the maximum timeline. Now, majority, there is no definition in this section, but however, we are taking Indian laws where 18 years is a majority age, one who can sign the contract at the age of 18. So we are considering at the age of 18, but you can keep 16, 17 also when you are writing the property, that at the age of 16, this should be handed over completely to Mr. So-and-so, the unborn person. So that is possible, but the maximum timeline will be within the timeline of pregnancy and attaining the age of majority. That means 18 years and period of gestation. Now, just period of gestation means after conceive to the time of delivery, when the kid is in the womb of mother, which is 9 months or 280 days, is called period of gestation. Now, that is the maximum timeline. 18 years and 280 days or 9 months is the maximum timeline that is available under section number 14. Now, this section gives some kind of exception to the section number 20. Section number 20 says immediately after the birth, the person, unborn person will get vested interest. But here you can extend. It gives an exception that you can extend it till the time of 18 years. That is possible. So please consider that and please remember that. Hope now you have concept clarity on the section number 14. With that assumption, I am moving on to the next slide. What are the essential ingredients? Rule against perpetuity, there are few major ingredients one need to consider, and I am taking you through them. The first one is there must be a transfer of property. Of course, the Transfer of Property Act deals with transfer of property. So when it comes to rule against perpetuity, yeah, requirement is there must be a transfer of property. And the second requirement is the transfer should be to create an interest in favor of an unborn person, that is ultimate beneficiary. When you are talking about rule against perpetuity, there will be one last person who is unborn and the interest is in favor of him, and he will be the ultimate beneficiary under rule against perpetuity. Now the third one is interest created must take effect after the lifetime of one or more persons living at the date of such a transfer and during the minority of the unborn person. Now you know it is interviewers, you cannot transfer a property directly to an unborn person. There should be an interest created between the unborn person. So that is the requirement which is spoken here in the third condition, that you should create an interest prior to the transfer of property to an unborn person, and then it will go to the unborn person and it can be extended to the extent of attaining majority. That's the timeline available under section number 14. Now the fourth one, the unborn person must be in existence at the expiration of the interest of the living person. Now this is very very important, that while the last transfer happens from the person who is having interest and next to the unborn person, the person who is having interest should be alive. Otherwise the transfer cannot happen. The only exception there you can see here is the pregnancy period. Otherwise the person should be alive to transfer the property to the next person or the unborn person. The vesting of the interest in favor of the ultimate beneficiary may be postponed only up to the lives of living persons plus the minority of the ultimate beneficiary, but not beyond that. I have already covered. So the maximum timeline will be to the any number of living person. There is no condition for the living persons, but the last person who is going to the beneficiary, if is unborn person, which is the requirement for section number 14, so it will go to one unborn person and he will get an absolute power on the property at the age of 18. You cannot extend anything above that. You cannot say I am transferring property to Mr. A who is a living person, and after that I am transferring the property to his son Mr. B when he attains the age of 23 years. Now you cannot do that. The moment you mention anything above 18, this transfer becomes invalid. Only to the living person you can have clauses of years, but for an unborn person, when he attains the maximum limit that you can put is his 18 years. So that's very clear under this section. Now the definition, I told there is no definition for minority or majority provided in this section, but there was a case Sundara Rajan versus Natarajan, AR 1925 UPC 244, where it was held that minority in India terminates at the age of 18 years or when the minor is under supervision of court at the age of 21 years. But in Sundara Rajan versus Natarajan case, Privy Council held that since at the date of transfer, it is not known whether or not a guardian would be appointed by court for the minor in future, for purpose of section number 14, the normal period of minority would be 18 years. So vesting can be postponed only up to the life of the prior interest holder and the minority, that is 18 years, of the ultimate beneficiary. Immediate transfer once he, she born. Okay, that is possible. Immediate transfer once he, she is born, possible. Vested interest, you can create a vested interest, but you can delay it to the extent of maximum 18 years when it is coming to the unborn person. After that, there will not be any delay available under this section. Now, why is this rule? Imagine if I can write my property to my son and then to my son's son and then to my son's son and then to my son's son, like that. If I write son and so many of continuity, what will happen? There will be a lot of challenges. So considering that, law has brought rule against perpetuity. Now, if we are talking about having rule against perpetuity, we need to understand what is the benefit of. Now, we understood the challenge that by having, or I will help you to understand what is the challenge as well as benefit when I am covering this, why this rule. The first one is, this section ensures that property doesn't remain in the same family for unlimited timeline. As I said, if I have an opportunity to write my property to any number of my next generation, then I can write to unlimited timeline and it will always remain to me. It will never transfer to anyone. And that, like in economy, it will not never move to any other person, or nobody else will get an opportunity to buy it. So that will become a burden to the society. How it becomes, when I read out all the benefits, you will understand it. These sections ensure that one can utilize his property for his benefit in true sense. Now, I hope this will help you to understand the benefit very clearly. Now, imagine you have a property, but you cannot do anything with that except for taking benefit out of the, like if you have an agriculture land, do agriculture and get the benefits out of the agriculture, but you cannot do anything more than that, like transfer or gift it to someone, sell it to someone. You cannot do anything of that. Then it becomes a burden on you, because when you have needy hours of your life, like you have financial difficulties, or you don't have assets or the facilities to manage the agriculture activities, but then just because it is already written unlimited timeline, you cannot do anything with that. Though you are facing economical difficulty, you will be tied up with that property. You cannot sell it. It's kind of like the property is held by the dead hands. Those hands which has written the property are been dead or not in the scene, but then property still cannot be transferred just because those dead hands were written that this cannot be transferred to anybody else other than the next unborn person. So to ensure that this doesn't happen, one can utilize his property in a true sense, this rule has come. This section helps for industrialization, etc. For example, if you got an agriculture land, you will do agriculture, your son will do agriculture, and after few years, if you see the image, there is agriculture land, and after that there is industries also. Now, how does industrialization happens? Industrialization happens with the capital investment, with the labor enforcement, with the profitability thinking people, all those stuff required, and land is also one of the requirement for the industrialization. Now, if everybody's property is tied up and if no one has the capital to invest on their agriculture land, and they cannot sell it to the one who can invest on the industrialization, now that becomes a dead land. Like it always remains same and it cannot change to the requirement of the economy. So when you have this section where you have an opportunity to sell the property, it helps to industrialization also. This section definitely helps government to earn extra income, because whenever you transfer the property, there will be registration and other stuffs are done. So government will also be benefited by this section with getting a lot of fees while the transfers are happened. Now, exceptions are there for section number 14. What are the exceptions? In few cases, you can have the perpetuity. That is, the important one is section number 18, which was talking about the public benefit, where advancement of religion, knowledge, commerce and health. If you are giving your property to some of this, definitely the exception is available. You can transfer it for a perpetual time. The major the restrictions in section number 14, 16, 17 shall not apply in the case of transfer of property for the benefit of the public in the advancement of religion, knowledge, commerce and health, which is read in section number 18. So personal contract, if you are having an agreement that do not create any interest in the property, are not affected by this rule. This rule applies only to transfer where there is a transfer of interest. Otherwise, this will not impact on personal contract also. Mortgage, as there is a future interest is not created, mortgage will also not come under this purview. This is an exception. then perpetual lease is also an exception section number 14, and vested interest and preemption. In this, there is an option of purchasing a land, and there is no question of any kind of interest in the property. So this rule does not apply in preemption also. Land and then land purchased by a corporation can live for a perpetual time. So there is no restriction of section number 14, that is rule against perpetuity, for land purchased by a corporation. And gift made for charity, if anybody is doing a gift or giving a gift to the purpose of charity, that can be for the time of perpetual, it can have a perpetual condition, because this is an exception under section number 14. And property settled for memorable public services are also an exception for section number 14. Moving on, I have tried to bring three major case laws pertaining to law against perpetuity, rule against perpetuity. First one is Anand Rao Vinayak versus Administrator General of Bombay. In this case, Bombay High Court declared that the gift is void as offering against perpetuity when a gift was made of movable property to a son with gift of shares in the property to son when they should attain the age of 21. So there was a gift made, and the last person who was getting was an unborn person, and the gift was mentioned that this unborn person will get the gift when he attains the age of 21. So I told you the maximum timeline available under rule against perpetuity is pregnancy and the minority. So that's the maximum age. So once he attains majority, that is age 18, it should go to the unborn person. If he is not getting absolute power at the age of 18, if any clauses brings hindrance to that, then this entire transfer becomes invalid. So in this case, as the age was mentioned, 21 years, it was held that this gift is void. Now, Abdul Fatah Muhammad versus Rasamaya, the Privy Council held that a gift to an unborn generation is forbidden by Mohammedan law except in the case of Waqf. Now, as per Mohammedan law, this doesn't apply for the unborn person. So, in this case, it was held that the section will not be applicable. Then, the Ram Baran versus Ram Mohit, Supreme Court held that the rule against perpetuity does not apply to the personal agreement, for example, agreements which do not create an interest in the property. So, personal agreement which do not create an interest in the property will not be affected with rule against perpetuity. These are the three major cases. In the first case, where the age was mentioned 21 years, the unborn person will get the gift when he attains the age of 21 years. That was told in Anand Rao Vinayak versus Administrator General of Bombay, and it was held that this gift was void. Abdul Fatah Muhammad versus Rasamaya, the gift was void because it was forbidden by Mohammedan law except for what. And Ramabaran versus Ram Mohit case, any agreements which do not create an interest in the property will not be against perpetuity. So it will not be applicable as to the personal agreement. This was held in the Ramabaran versus Ram Mohit case. Now, when you are reading section number 14, I hope you remember that when you are reading section number 13, you have to read the Indian Succession Act 1925, section number 113. Likewise, when you are reading section number 14, please also read section number 114 of Indian Succession Act 1925. You can refer this in your exam, that rule against perpetuity of Indian Succession Act reads, no bequest is valid where by the vesting of the thing bequeathed may be delayed beyond the lifetime of one or more persons living at the testator's death and the minority of some person who shall be in existence at the expiration of the period, and to whom, if he attains full age, the thing bequeathed is to belong. Now they are telling full age, there it was told majority. There is no much difference between these two sections, so you can read them together. Now remember, when you are reading section number 14, you need to have awareness of section number 15, 16, 17, 18. You need to also have awareness on section number 13, that is unborn person. Section number 20, which speaks about the vested interest for the unborn person, that also you need to remember. And I hope I have covered majority of the things. Ultimately, remember that one cannot tie his property for an unlimited time. That's the first thing. He can transfer his property to any number of living people. There is no condition for the transfer of property to the number of living persons. There is no condition. Finally, he can transfer his property to one unborn person. But when such unborn person is taking birth, the previous interest holder should be alive. That is a requirement here. And the maximum time that you can hold the property even after the birth of that unborn person is the age of majority, which is 18 years for the case of India. The majority age as per contract act is also 18 years. So after 18, you cannot delay any further. You have to transfer the entire property to that unborn person who is born now and attaining the age of 18, who will get absolute interest on the property. That's all for this session. Hope this session helps. All the best for your exams, and read more and more on section 13, 14 and other related sections to understand different other case laws. Thank you so much for watching the video. Please subscribe my channel, like and share my videos. Thank you so much.